Well, good evening and welcome to the ICA. I'm Paul Mason. I'm a journalist and a writer and a filmmaker. And I thought because we were on the mall, and actually it's the Trooping of the Colour, I could actually introduce the panellists in the style of Nicholas Witchell as a kind of, you know, it's here on the mall, veterans of Gleneagles and Prague. Because I won't. But I will introduce them as people I've actually mainly met, first of all, in the context of protest. Not all of them, and one of them I've even got the original name on my telephone is the name that they gave me that was the false name on the protest when I was a bourgeois journalist actually covering it. I won't name which person it is, but so where we are is that. In the short space of time of, I think, 5 years, we have gone from a situation where a relatively young cohort of activists and thinkers on the radical left has come, quite substantially in from the edges of the conversation to the very centre of it, both here in Britain, internationally, and as we're about to hear first, in the United States. As we just mentioned, the book, the event is themed around Sarah Leonard's and Bhaskar Sunkara's book, The Future We Want, Radical Ideas for the New Century. And I hope you'll be able to hear some radical ideas from the panel, which I'm about to introduce. So, Sarah Leonard is senior editor at The Nation and co-editor of the book, The Future We Want. She's also a contributing editor at Dissent and to The New Inquiry and co-editor of Occupy! Scenes from Occupied America. Aaron Bastani is the co-founder of Novara Media, a writer and a broadcaster. Emma Dowling is senior lecturer in sociology at Middlesex University. Her work covers themes such as effective labour, gender and social reproduction. Dr. Faiza Shaheen is an economist, writer, activist and commentator and the director of CLASS, the Centre for Labour and Social Studies think tank. Right, so Sarah, we're going to hear from you. And those of us who are engaged with the American situation know, what do we see? We see Bernie Sanders on a big platform, sometimes accompanied by Small Bird for no apparent reason. Then we see, we tweet about it, and then a horde of Hillary Clinton supporters call us chauvinists and pigs and things. And then we see protests at the Trump rallies, but we're pretty convinced that beneath this there must be something amazing going on. Tell us about it, and tell us about the gender politics of it as well.
Sure. So thank you so much for being here. It's really, really fantastic to be here. And I've been excited to be in a country for a little bit that has actually existing left institutions and spaces, which I am not familiar with. And it really feels quite good, it turns out. So when we were putting the book together, a lot has changed since the time we even started thinking about it. It says radical solutions on the cover. They're really sort of socialist solutions, which is how we think about them. But we did not think that that would be a good selling point on the cover back when we were putting this together. We're like, that's not really going to draw the eye in America. Turns out we made a mistake. And everybody is amped on socialism at the moment. To give a little bit of backstory, and then hopefully we'll just sort of have a conversation about it. Since 2011, I believe, polls in the U.S. have shown that young people look more favorably on the idea of socialism than the idea of capitalism. This is a generation that has massive student debt, an average of $35,000, can't get jobs, is definitely approaching a standard of living that is lower than their parents. Probably you have heard these things, many of which we have in common. And it's not really clear that anyone who is responding to that poll has any idea what socialism means. They just feel that capitalism is not working very well for them, and they're totally right. So since roughly that 2011 period, and the reason for asking such a question in a Pew poll, which is not like their go-to every year historically, was Occupy, right? So Occupy kicked off with a generation that had a lot of expectations about what we were entitled to. And it was a good kind of entitlement. We're entitled to a better standard of living. We're entitled to doing well if we go to college, et cetera. It was thwarted completely by the financial crisis. And so that sort of bubbled up into what we saw. Occupy had a very nebulous sort of politics, as I suspect many of you are aware, and it was more oppositional than it was programmatic, and I think we needed that at the time. No young person at that time could have come out of a labor union or another left institution that teaches you how to organize in a specific way, because those institutions have all been under assault in the U.S. since the late 70s. And so we saw that movement coming out. It was followed more recently by Black Lives Matter, which is a tremendously important movement and the most vital movement really in the States right now, I would say, outside of the electoral realm. And this movement attacked racism on all fronts, which so profoundly structures American inequality. And throughout all of this, there's the fight for 15, which was our fight for a higher minimum wage. So you have all of these movements churning at the same time, people learning how to organize. And Bernie Sanders, I think, is the product of that. I think often Bernie Sanders is looked upon as someone who inspired Americans to get interested in socialism, interested in the left, start organizing, but really other people created the space wherein his candidacy would even be possible. And so I think that's really important to keep in mind. This is a generation, notably, and the biggest difference between him and every other candidate demographically, from Trump to Clinton, is the proportion of his base that is young people. 85% of young people voted for him in most of the primaries, which is crazy. That's a really high number. And so this is a generation, of course, that was born after 1989. No one's afraid of like socialists taking their stuff. But during the financial crisis, their parents lost homes. They couldn't get a job. They were screwed over. They're afraid of Wall Street taking their stuff, right? There's a total reversal in mentality. And so this has opened up a very wide space for a socialist politics. And the question now, and what we're trying to think about in the book, is how we structure that space, what it actually looks like. And I could go on, or someone could jump in.
Well, I will jump in before we go to the other panelists. What's the American part of the answer to why across the world do there seem to be a generation quite similar to the demographic in this room, which you can see is fairly young in terms of meetings that people go to, and then symbolic old guys, symbolic old left-wing guy is kind of it's everywhere. I mean, you've got, you know, Corbyn, five-star movement in Italy. Even the Central Committee of Syriza is the same age as Corbyn. I mean, Tsipras was kind of the youth wing. So why? Why has that happened?
Well, I think there's a pretty simple explanation for it, which is that they represent a generation that was engaged in organized left redistributive politics. And that and the generation between us and them, or the generations plural, was part of a different politics that was not as reflective of economic crisis. And so I think we're looking to them for some amount of leadership. But it is hilarious. I mean, it's like Bernie Sanders and everyone else is 25. And when, you know, there are a certain number of Hillary supporters who get on his case for being sexist, and I hope we'll talk about that, because that's like the bulk of what I talk about in the States as a female Sanders supporter. And notably, female young women have gone to vote for Sanders at the same rate as men. I mean, that's equal. But in terms of the sort of old man question, you know, everyone's like, well, he's on stage and he's like yelling at Hillary and he's waving his arms around. I'm like, that's like my Zeta. It's like, it looks pretty familiar, Brooklyn Jew. And so there is a sort of funny generational thing that gets translated in all kinds of ways. But I think the politics reflect each other because of the era they're politically active in.
What about the middle bit, though? I mean, you know, the generation in their sort of 40s, 50s, and early 60s.
Yeah, Paul?
Where did they... Yeah. You know, Where did they go? Where did they go?
Where did you go?
Where did they go? I mean, I know where I went. I mean, but where did they go? You
know. I know you've been here. Maybe someone else.
No, I want you to answer about America. What? I
mean. Okay. Oh, it's a good question. Okay, so it depends on which sort of political space you're talking about, but in the same way that you had New Labor, we had the New Democrats, and there was an era of the Democratic Party realigning itself to be more favorable to business, and that was a conscious process. And if you look at there's been some really good work on this by people like Donna Murch. When they were trying to strategize, the Democratic Party did a certain amount of demographic research, and they found that, shockingly, white voters had a problem with their support of civil rights and Black Americans, racism being alive and well as the primary divider in American politics. And they thought, how do we realign ourselves so that our emphasis is less on the welfare state, which tends to be coded as supporting people of color, and more sort of business friendly, more et cetera, et cetera. And we all know the story of welfare reform in the 90s, and a pretty ugly set of reforms, which did, however, successfully realign the Democratic Party with business. And so this party, which had absorbed most of left of center in America, we have a very rigid two-party system, sort of moved rightward, taking a lot of people with it, and failed to represent a generation that then got well and truly screwed over by the latest financial crash. And so we didn't have a structure to turn to or a generation to turn to and say, like, okay, we're kind of all in the same boat. It really was a bit starting from square one. And so when people were like looking at Occupy or something and they think, why are all these young people running around having drum circles? Don't they know how a real revolution works or real change? Or like, why don't they just go vote? It was a ridiculous response because, first of all, there were very few choices in voting. And on the other hand, we had very little background in infrastructure or money to be doing the type of organizing work that people seem to think is serious. The labor unions totally got behind Occupy in a way that was quite lovely and not necessarily a given. Mm-hmm. But the ways that they were organizing themselves were not ways that were working all that well either.
So what does your... what does the generation mobilized around Sanders do if he doesn't get the nomination? I was in Boston, I think, on the day that he... No, I was in New York on the day he failed to win Brooklyn. The day he failed to win New York State. And there was an interesting moment because he went, okay... Southern Black America didn't vote for us because it's conservative. And then somebody threw him a question about gun control. And they said, well, why are you so soft on guns? And he said, because we have to reach out to every state, i.e. meaning a bunch of kind of, presumably subtextually, people who like guns. And it did, you know, without using any more stereotypes, it did really illustrate to me that he does seem to have a kind of deaf ear on Southern Black politics. Why?
He's from Vermont. It's a like 95% white state in the Northeast. That's why he likes guns. Vermonters like guns. And honestly, guns are not a massive problem in Vermont. They're a big problem all over the country on one level or another. But the gun issue is not the same in Vermont as it is in New York. But when it comes to southern states, this, I think, and many people think, has been a mistake. So he fairly accurately assessed that he might do better among white working class people, especially in the Northeast and the Midwest, than he would with Black people in the South. And so because the campaign at the beginning lacked resources, or like, okay, we're going to focus where we can win. What this didn't take into consideration was any left coalition has to be a strong multiracial coalition. It doesn't work otherwise, and you wouldn't want it to work otherwise. It's ridiculous. And to think that if you won only white votes, you would still appear to be credible on the left was a huge miscalculation. And there is much deeper infrastructure in the South for the Democratic Party, which has been very important in winning civil rights and so forth, or at least reflecting those victories electorally. So those voters are not surprisingly less inclined to go with someone who they don't know, who until recently was not part of the Democratic Party, which helped facilitate the enshrinement of civil rights. And so they're not all that interested in him, and he didn't campaign very well there. But still there, he won within the black vote, which people always refer to as the black vote. It is a little weird. It's black people vote for different things. And in the case of the South, as everywhere else, younger voters were more likely to go for Sanders. So there's clearly work to be done there, and he clearly could have done better there had he spent the time.
Okay, Aaron Bastani. Sanders comes from Vermont. Islington is the Vermont of Britain, except that instead of guns, they prefer Manchego cheese. You have kind of lived your political life online. We can follow what you were tweeting in 2011. We can follow more.
I do have a life offline as well.
It's more or less what you were doing.
Hard for some to believe.
Yeah. More or less what you're doing in 2011. And it's an interesting trajectory, isn't it? From protest, student protest, Occupy, to, you know, you're now publicly a big voice in favor of Corbyn. What's going on with Corbyn? And we know, I mean, those of us who've in the media and you know, around the media, are well aware of the kind of, you know, God, I nearly used the word Goebbels-like, but, you know, pretty bad sort of onslaught that Corbyn has faced from the mainstream media. Yeah. So what can you do about it, and how do you analyse what's going on?
Well, I just want to say thank you to everybody for coming, first and foremost. That it's a packed-out crowd, I think, betokens something really interesting. And it also synergizes what you were saying about how things have changed since 2010. I'm sure many of the audience have come from protest situations as well, and they've seen their politics develop in a similar kind of way. In regard to what you're saying about Corbyn, and also, by the way, I think Islington child poverty is pretty high. So a comparison to Vermont is, you know, a bit difficult. Sanders. So what coalition is needed for the left to win? In the words of Gramsci, what would a historic bloc look like? What would hegemony look like? What are the demographics you would need to bring together around a range of shared interests? Actually looks a little bit like what Obama does in 2008, 2012, right? Women, young people, people of color. I think Obama in 08 is the first guy to win the presidency who doesn't win the baby boomer vote since the late 70s. So that's big. And I think Sanders, by neglecting African Americans, by neglecting the reality of having to build that exact same coalition, sure, not as easy for him as it was for Obama because he's not an African-American. Neglecting that was a big mistake. And I think we're seeing something similar with Corbyn. I don't think there's necessarily a structured strategy around the kinds of interests, the kinds of demographics that need to be pulled together, not to be 1 or 2 points ahead in the opinion polls, but to win a general election, which of course will have to happen off the back of the English vote. We now know that. And I think a similar mistake's been made, actually. So, yeah, how that relates to the media is, I would say, you would need key frames, you would need key messages, policies, of course, demands, appealing to each of these three demographics, like I say, people of colour, young people, women, to bring them in. And then that, there would have to be an attendant media strategy with that, okay? And what would that look like? Well, you could almost neglect the print media, I think, right? Given that, you know, you're looking at over 50s are on that stuff, but, you know, I'm not so sure how key it would be. And yeah, that's it really. I think there's not the sense with Corbyn, just like Sanders, that in order to win hegemony, in order to really dominate the sort of media narrative, you have to be a little bit more nuanced about this.
What is it then that's missing? I mean, is it policies? Is it political strategy? Because, you know, behind, I presume, Sanders, I've met one or two people who are political strategists in the Sanders arena, but certainly behind Clinton and certainly behind Obama, you had these, you know, these beefed up political strategists. What would a political strategist say to Corbyn?
Well, I mean, if you the people behind Obama, paradoxically, of course, were white suits. People like David Axelrod. Yeah, I think he had 15, 16 people in his kind of inner circle, almost all white men. There just aren't the resources for Corbyn to call upon, right? I mean, who has he got? He's got Ken Livingstone, you know? So it's a very, very different thing. And also, this is something I hope we can maybe talk about a little bit. Maybe Sarah can talk about it. Is in the States with the Howard Dean campaign, that's 2003. The Sanders campaign has almost been in the offing now for over a decade. I actually think here in the UK, I said we're at the beginning of that process. I'm not going to be so simplistic as to say that, you know, Howard Dean, Jeremy Corbyn, same person, same role. But the infrastructure that Corbyn has looks to me remarkably like what Howard Dean found in 2003. Now, who comes out of Howard Dean? What comes out of Howard Dean? Really important sedimentary networks, right? So two of the writers that were writing on the Dean blog were Matt Iglesias and who's this other guy?
Ezra Klein,
right? So the big voices, you know, the kind of left-right in the States right now come out of that. Blue State Digital runs the Obama campaign in 2008. Those were the tech people behind Howard Dean. Echo Ditto, their number one competitor. They also come out of the people behind Howard Dean. Democracy for America, that was originally Dean for America. They were the big endorsement for Obama before 08. So there was a lot building up to just Obama. And we haven't got, you're saying you've not got left institutions in the US, it's nice to them over here. We haven't got the soft left institutions, perhaps, that would favour a more radical candidate, which I think in the US they've had since Dean.
But we have got quite a big base of engaged, I wouldn't call necessarily activists, I would, you know, people who are, when called upon, will turn up to do things and will, I mean, clearly the Corbyn won because people were able to put together quite an effective grassroots campaign. Now, what does it look like? What does it look like on the inside with Corbyn? It looks like a lot of, you know, older Labour people, and the people who are working for them are still quite in that deferential kind of Labour staffer mode. And they have to be, because they have to deliver against really quite, you know, vicious sort of machinery of Parliament. You can't wander in there with a kind of T-shirt and go like, well, where's the canteen? You've got to know how it works. But, you know, how would you think that Corbyn could translate the... I think he's got hold of the Labour Party now for at least 12 months. There's not going to be a revolt. What would he do to be able to move from being sort of Howard Dean to being someone who could win with a radical mass base?
So I've got a few friends working inside Labour HQ, one of who's recently left. Let's say not friends, contact sources, and I might say that, but that's what they are, right? A source told me. And right now, Labour HQ is an awful place to work. You can literally get nothing done if you're actually trying to do anything positive. Tom Watson's pulling his hair out more than anybody else, apparently. So what would have to happen? There would have to be a culture change there. We obviously know that's not going to happen. What would have to happen? Great question. I think in the short term, you would need organisations set up around McDonnell, around Corbyn, which would be well-funded, well-resourced, and have almost plausible deniability. What really impressed me, actually, in the last couple of months was the role of Order, Guido Fawkes, in kind of stimulating this whole anti-Semitism debacle. Now, I'm not excusing what Ken Livingstone did. I think he was rightfully suspended. But it's clear that there was something triggered by Guido Fawkes, Paul Staines, and that interacted very impressively, actually, with the red tops and the tabloid media. I think that there are people around Corbyn who think they could do something similar, actually, in terms of setting the media agenda. So the JC4PM social media assets, for instance, or JC4, yeah, they were previously JC4 leader. They were set up during the leadership campaign. And in the States, the people behind this, I think, would have been the first people on the payroll once Corbyn won the leadership. Over here, they're not even getting their emails, you know, sort of responded to. So there's a big difference there. Why is that happening? I think it's... People could say, well, the Labour machine, how do you turn it around? That's part of it. But I also think at the personnel level, there are people around Corbyn, less so around McDonnell, who just aren't up to it.
Well, interesting. Right, I'm going to move on. And Faiza, tell us a bit about class, your where you work, your think tank, but also tell us a bit about what the work you've been able to do that does answer some of these questions. Where does Corbyn resonate? Where does the left? Does the left radicalism that brought him to power resonate? And where does it not?
Yeah, so Class is a think tank. It's been around for a few years, and I've been there for 3 months. And very much focused on inequality in the economy, and very much trying to push this need to think again about class. And it has been a narrative that's reemerged recently in some ways. But I find it quite interesting how it's handled within the kind of Corbyn left. I don't know if you guys saw, but interestingly, I think over the weekend, Corbyn was asked if he's middle class or not. And he really struggled with the question, basically saying initially, like, oh, I don't know, I haven't thought of myself like that, and eventually admitting that he is middle class. And I don't know what that's about. I know there's something about a kind of, is there still a taboo about talking about class, or is it that he's just never kind of recognized, where he sits, which is quite weird. But certainly for me, I think the class narrative is really important here, and important because we do have a long way to go, and I agree in terms of Corbyn. And I was just saying that I was speaking to my hairdresser about this and asking her if she knew who Corbyn was. And she didn't know who he was. She votes Labour, but she was... It was after I explained, she said, oh, now you say his name, maybe I kind of know. And this is a woman of colour, who does vote Labour, isn't very politically engaged, but lives in London. So you would have thought that she would have heard of him. And I think there's a real issue with how far this message is going. And I think very often, you know, we on the left feel like everyone thinks or knows similar things to us, and they don't necessarily. And with Corbyn, I think... you can see in the makeup of the new membership, actually, that this isn't a kind of old Labour in the way that it was a very working class grassroots movement. This is a kind of left movement that is very much supported by kind of, highly skilled professionals are city dwellers. That has been the kind of big membership surge. And that's not a bad thing necessarily, but when we think about the kind of change we need to see, we have to start thinking about the working class. And we're so behind on that because obviously the working class are voting less and less for Labour and more for UKIP. And that presents its own issues. So what Corbyn and the party needs to say around immigration and issues for the working class is a big one. And I think that's being missed right now. And I think for me, the reason why we need to think much more about this cross-section of support and not just a kind of London Islington idea of kind of Corbyn. And I think, I mean, someone said recently, and it was someone bemoaning the Labour Party, but saying that there's more people in the shadow cabinet from Islington than the whole of the Northeast, which, you know, you don't really want those kind of stats. I think that if... for kind of the types of policies that Corbyn will come out with, which will be very much a kind of socialist agenda, you can't do that without reaching out to people and getting to think less about themselves, which they've been told to do for many, many years now, and more about each other. And that requires us reaching out to those people that have been left behind by the neoliberal agenda. That probably doesn't answer your question, but essentially, I feel... that we need, there's a long way to go, and that without the kind of working class narrative and without reaching that, Corbyn will have a very hard time. And it's not just about women and women of colour, it is about a particular group of people that have been really disadvantaged by neoliberalism.
I mean, in his defence, none of the Northeast Labour MPs want to be in the shadow cabinet, do they?
Yeah.
That's the problem. and the other thing is, I mean, it's interesting you say, more and more working class people, that vote UKIP. But what I think this is a conundrum, and it's not been answered either by the 2014 Euro elections or by the 2015 general election. what do we know about the split between basically people who would have been working class Tories, all, you know, and therefore, you know, impenetrable even at the at the height of, say, 1970s Bennism to Labour, and people who genuinely believe they're in some way sort of identified as left-wing working class people who are just so fed up about migration and Europe that they've flipped. Do we know anything about that, that split?
I mean, I've had these conversations a lot with my father-in-law, who's exactly that.
Which
kind
one?
Of voted Labour, and now is very disgruntled having seen the factory that he works in change massively, and now is, you know, threatens to vote UKIP and to vote and wants to vote to leave the EU, and will vote, I guess, to leave the EU. I think the truth of that is that we have to take the issue of immigration very, very seriously, in a way that we still seem to ignore on the left. We still see it as a kind of almost like you can't say anything about it because otherwise we're racist. And we have to talk much more about the other drivers of why it is that my father-in-law has found his wages not go up, etc. Because, and we haven't for many years spoken about deunionization. We haven't spoken about the way technology change has adversely affected certain groups of the population. And as the longer we ignore that narrative, the longer there's a void for others to come in.
Okay, Emma Dowling, your work focuses, or your academic work is focused on caring, you know, caring work, and also these workers at the extreme end of precarity, where they can even be forced or sometimes volunteer to use their emotional labour just to sort of stay in a job. So I just wondered whether you could talk to us a bit about how, you know, this utterly sort of basic fact that works across Western economies now, America, the Europe and the UK, of precarity plays in to, I mean, we all know the problem, I think, but how does precarity affect our search for solutions?
That's a very good question. Well, I think first of all, we have to think about what precarity means. What does it mean to be precarious? We see on the one hand, precariousness means people don't have permanent job contracts, there is casualization, lots of freelance work, zero-hour contracts. There are lots of different forms of precarity also across the sort of class spectrum. So you have, on the one hand, you might have your sort of freelance workers doing project work across creative industries, media, that sort of thing, and art, but then sort of lower down, zero-hour contracts, also in academia, zero-hour contracts, but often in sort of what are considered to be lower income jobs like caring professions, and also retail and hospitality industry, which is, I think, 19% of jobs in London are in the retail and hospitality sector, so quite a high amount. And here, precariousness refers to your employment situation, but it also refers to the fact that you can't really expect perhaps the kind of pension or sick pay or the kinds of social security benefits that you might have had in the past under a sort of different regime of a Fordist economy. But particularly, I would say that precariousness also has a kind of emotional structure to it. It means that not only are you faced with these sort of material conditions of increased risk and less security, but also you feel it as something quite embodied, that you don't know where the next paycheck is going to come from. You don't know what your future is going to look like. And this sort of promise of flexibility as something that is about freedom and doing what you love, and or simply being able to work when you want to work, often the argument for zero-hour contracts, in favor of zero-hour contracts, is that, well, this is good for students and people who have caring responsibilities, because it means that then they can work when they need to. Zero-hour contracts means that actually you are always having to be on, even though you might not be guaranteed the hours. That's not a situation in which you have the freedom to choose when to work so that you can take care of children or other family members. So this kind of emotional anxiety around insecurity is very much part of precariousness, as is, of course, increased debt. A lot of the time now, our income is not made up purely of a wage, which we struggle to get, but also of debt. And that in itself also has a kind of emotional structure around wondering how you're going to be able to pay back that debt, also feeling ashamed if you're not able to make your debt payments, and worrying about the future in that respect. So I think taken together, this sort of affective, emotional state of precariousness also leads to an anxiety which makes it very difficult to imagine a possible future or sort of positive idea of a future. And of course, also, if you are in precarious work, then the traditional union structure doesn't work in the same way for you. And of course, also, if you are precarious, you are very individualized often in your work, even if there is a lot of talk about collaboration and project work, and where people are getting together with other people to realize whatever it is that they're trying to do. But you are very individualized. And so that, I think, also means that people are looking to themselves rather than to other people in terms of how they're trying to lead their lives and deal with their problems. So I think all of these things are barriers towards trying to organize.
I mean, it's an interesting discussion then, in terms of, we have now, you know, a radical left Labour Party. We also have, you know, the SNP with 2/3 of its membership joined from Labour on a purportedly on left-wing basis. You've got, you know, left-wing Green parties, etc. The interesting thing is that when you ask people, okay, well, how would we abolish precarity? You tend to draw a blank. Because people can't imagine. So, I mean, I grew up, you know, as you pointed out so kindly, that I am from a generation where there was no precarious work. You literally, you couldn't, you were trying to leave your summer job in a factory in September, in the summer, and they were literally trying to stop you and say, don't go to university. You know, please stay here and be, you know, what is it? A tool setter. One guy once said to me, if you give up your music degree, you could become a tool setter. And, to now, which is like, F off, you know, even if you've got a degree, you can do coffee bar work. So what would we do? I'm wondering whether all the panel might want to weigh in. What could radical politics do to make inroads into this condition?
Well, I think, first of all, it's not going to be settled by just simply a set of demands to a government, or also a manifesto or a program by a political party. I think that what we're dealing with at the moment is also the question of how we reproduce our lives in common. And that I think it's no accident that we're also seeing lots of movements, not only here in the UK, but also other countries in Europe, organizing around social reproduction, around different aspects of their lives that are important to them in order to live, whether that is education, whether that's housing. Also, I think what's interesting is what's happening around utilities, energy and water, but also questions about what we would call an unfinished feminist revolution, housework, childcare, elder care, all of these things. How do we do this work in a way that is different from how we have done it so far, in a way that is not just offloading all of that onto particular people, notably women, often women of color? And how do we find a different way of organizing ourselves across these different aspects of our lives, and in a way that's not just orientated around a market economy and as new areas for capital accumulation, which finance is very interested in at the moment. So I think that, to my mind, is a really important question. And I think it's not a question that we ask on a panel. I think it's a question that movements are posing themselves at the moment.
I mean, is what you're saying something like, I mean, as a journalist, I've reported again and again on zero-hours contract work. and some really brave people stand up and they join the union in a cafe with five workers, where in addition to 0 hours, it's often harassment, sexual harassment, all off the books, pay, everything. And you always come to a point where you say, well, what would happen if you actually won? And they kind of look at their shoes a bit and they go, the cafe would close because it couldn't exist without all this. So is there a sense in which the demand for really radical change to this is almost like impossible to achieve through populist consent?
Can I come back on that just for one thing? Because I think another aspect of this that's really important is we have to also ask the question about what a meaningful life is beyond simply work. Mm. And I think a lot of the conversation is organized around work, particularly when we talk about precariousness and 0 hours contracts. We get stuck, I think, in this idea of how do we make our work better or how do we improve our wages, whereas actually we need to be asking a much more radical question about how we live our lives beyond simply seeing ourselves as labor power, which is only ever a means to an end anyway, because we have to get an income from somewhere.
Sarah?
Yeah, I could not agree more with that, absolutely. And I think that's one reason why ideas like a universal basic income have become popular in the States. The idea being you give everyone an allowance from the state just for being human. You know, everyone is born with money. And I do think one reason is when we try to think about rolling back this obviously awful state of precarity, you really think about going back and you're like, okay, so do I want to go back to the assembly line? Like, no one wants that. No one liked it at the time. And so you have to think, as you're saying, of a way forward. And so one way of doing that is by thinking, well, how do we want to structure our lives? Well, maybe work gives us meaning to some degree, but work primarily is a space in which we are oppressed. And actually, leisure in many ways is much more important and is the space in which human creativity is allowed to flourish, in which we spend time with our families and the people we love. And so how do we create that as a priority in our organizing? And so some people like Kathy Weeks have written about this. How do we have a movement not just for different labor, but for less labor or for no labor? Like, screw work. Work sucks. and so this is particularly obvious in the realms of care work, where it's not particularly clearly structured by the market. It's very much structured by the market, but in a messy way. So in the book, we talk about childcare, which may not sound like the most radical demand on earth, but this is something we don't have in the United States on a social basis. It's extremely expensive. And too many people actually die in childcare because it's done by unlicensed people in homes. It's not well regulated or, most importantly, funded. And people still send their kids to these places because they have to work. And how else are you going to work? So that is one realm where the demand very clearly should be on the state. This is something that should be considered collective, not just because we need it in order to go to work, but because as long as we don't have it, women are going to be unequal in all kinds of things since they do the majority of care labor. It's actually hard to go to an organizing meeting if you have to watch your kids. It's a boon for the left to have universal childcare. And furthermore, it's a way to think collectively about our future. We are all responsible for the next generation, for children. It's not something that should be pushed back onto the individual family. And so thinking about even what a family is for and how it's structured and whether we like the way that families work is a fairly radical reimagining of our day-to-day lives that I think actually can take place through a more concrete and less complicated demand, which is childcare.
Do either of you two want to come back on this precarity discussion?
I guess more to come back on your point about what we can do and what we need to do. And I think for me, I'm come much more from a statsy, geeky background and having worked a lot on economic inequality for quite some time and seen it kind of get more popular. But The thing that strikes me about it is that we've had this conversation on economic inequality change radically, and yet nothing has happened. In fact, during this time, we've seen this rise in big business and politicians saying this is the defining issue of our time. Inequality has got worse for most countries in the world. So for me, thinking about that, you know, as a failure, kind of as an economist and a researcher, is that evidence isn't everything. And of course, in order to have change, we have to do something about the inequality in power. And so the movement building part of this and absolutely needs to support that radical agenda, but you can't support a radical agenda unless you have enough people on side. So that this discussion that we're having today about how you build movements is really the first step for me. And I say that as someone that comes from a much more kind of policy geeky background. And it struck me years ago, I worked for a think tank that said that we kind of put out this idea around a very different way, radical way of working, where we would just have 21 hours a week. We'd work 21 hours a week. And I remember there was a real split in the office because some people were really excited about this idea. And to be honest, they were from quite middle and upper middle class backgrounds. They, you know, had an allotment. They were, you know, what I would term as very white. And then there was the...
Was one of them called Jeremy?
Yeah, and then there were people that were the the receptionists and the other people that were really worried about this idea and saw it as something that was like, what does this mean for my work? I don't earn enough money to work 21 hours a week, and you guys aren't thinking about people like me. So I think it again comes back to the way that we make this really a movement that is cross-sectional in every meaning of the term.
Right, which is interesting in the States because a lot of the universal basic income stuff has gotten really popular in Silicon Valley. And for them, they want it because they think everything should be a personal choice. So you give everyone an income and then you take away all the social services. And everyone can just like shop for them. Yeah, it's horrible. It's a terrible idea. And so there are obviously better and worse ways to structure this. But, you know, I think a thing we tend to forget in the States at any rate is that the labor movement is the movement that limited the work week. It put a cap on how much you could work. It created the weekend. And that this is a legacy that has often been forgotten in the era when you have to struggle just to make a decent wage, just to have a job, to not be entirely contingent. And I do think that's a legacy that is built into labor that could be reclaimed for a sort of agenda that takes away things like basic income, certain kinds of redistribution from people like, you know, Peter Thiel. And that's important to imagine, because otherwise I do think it's easy for us in the sort of work on the left, the work that is organizing as well as writing, whatever, it's hard to do without the imagination of what we want. Mm. It's very hard for that imagination not to be straitjacketed by the ways in which we're screwed over right now.
Can I come in on that? Because I think also we have to ask questions that go beyond simply redistribution. And I think what's interesting to me about much of the organizing that's going on within movements at the moment is posing the question also of alternatives and alternative ownership models. And so I think precisely as you say, this kind of vision of a different future has to, I think, go beyond simply thinking about income and redistribution and what might a sort of alternative ownership model for utilities look like? What might alternative infrastructures around social care look like? And how do we own those in common in a way that actually we create a different kind of conditions for living and not sort of stuck in these negotiations, I think, with power in a way that I think is quite limiting.
I mean, it's all been said, hasn't it? I think with precarity, I think you don't have to reinvent the wheel. I think you would take things like housing, transport, education out of commodity circulation. You know, like we had not that long ago. And then I think once you've done the fundamentals, and I think we're particularly housing, right, in somewhere like London, that would just make so many people's lives so much better. And then I think
And then you would go for the maximum working week stuff. Then you'd go for the guaranteed social wage. Because those are the frames people classically understand. I think that would find much, much greater scale amongst working class voters. So, yeah.
It's interesting because when you talk to the Corbyn team, they see all that kind of stuff as really left field and what they might get to, you know, in this sort of second or third term of that they're so...
When he's 90.
Exactly. So that, in the sense that, no, I mean, you know, it's hard enough to go to, you know, the centre of the Labour Party, PLP, the parliamentary party, and say, you know, raising the minimum wage to a decent level. Or even, you know, who knew that half of these new MPs love McDonald's as an employer? I mean, even criticising McDonald's gets you kind of slammed as a sort of ultra-left Trotskyist now. But I think what's coming out of this discussion is, in actual fact, something like they may have to leap over to that agenda, whether it's alternative ownership models, to basic things to deal with the precariat's obsessions, before they'll even engage them as a...
Can I also say, I think, don't be surprised if some Tory MPs start to say this stuff before the right of the Labour Party does.
Mm.
Particularly people around Boris Johnson, I think. If you're seeing what Trump's now saying around, for instance, dollar devaluation, around tariffs, around minimum wage, I mean, he's triangulating very intelligently. And I think, just like with Sanders, you know, he's also a reaction to globalization, or a particular kind of globalization, yeah. Who's losing out. And I think more intelligent elements of the right, both sides of the Atlantic, will cotton on to that. And yeah, don't be surprised if they do before the Labour right does, because they're the last People's 20 party.
Right, with that, welcome to any Blairite MPs who are sitting in the audience.
Hello, Tristan.
We'll throw it to the audience. There's somebody with a mic. If you want to stick your hand up, please keep your questions pithy, and then we can get some more discussions. But does anybody want to answer? Person over there who looks remarkably to me like... No, it's Laurie's sister. Hello.
Yeah, it's the other one. Hi. on terms of these kind of policies being potentially recouped by an extreme right wing or just regular right wing agenda. How do you think we structure a universal basic income such that it doesn't sort of stabilize capitalism by stabilizing basic demand? Because obviously that's been a fuel of successive crises that have foregrounded exactly these kind of conversations.
Anybody want to? Now, let's have three at a time. Go on. Person there with hand up. Right. Just wait a minute, people with the mic. Keep your hand up. Yeah, you, sir, there. Yeah, that's him. And then you with the tie.
Hello. I'm Nick. I'm from Global Justice Now. I want to... there's two worries I've got about the conversation. One is, I think Corbyn's success has made us somewhat fixated on a parliamentary process that in the past we've never been interested in. And I'm really worried about this because all Corbyn does is provide us with a space. It's for us to change it. And so, you know, there's a million things a day that Corbyn says that I'd like him to say slightly differently. It really doesn't make any difference. If we don't make that change, it's not going to happen. And the second one is, part of that change for me, the essential part of that change is mobilizing and educating. And I think we've come to think of change in a very Blairite way as all about communications. It's not about communications. And, you know, I was really struck when I was watching a documentary about Negri. Negri in the 70s used to get up at 5 o'clock and go and sell newspapers outside a car factory and talk to the workers, and he'd be at his desk at 9:30 in the university. I don't do that. I'm guessing not many of us do that. But actually, that's a recognition of where change is going to come from, because our politics cannot be achieved through good communications. They can only be achieved through the mobilization of many, 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 many more people than are involved in this at the moment.
Sir, here.
I guess my question's about party structure, particularly with Labour, as someone who's kind of matches a lot of the trajectory you've talked about tonight, sort of single issue movements moving into the Labour Party to support Corbyn and now getting more involved. It really strikes me there's a huge culture clash between the people who have come into the Labour Party from that background and the people who are there now, in terms of there's a big base of people to the left of kind of Labour's social democracy, but their politics are so different in terms of, you know, were interested in organising kind of reading groups and support networks, all those kind of things. It's just not in their political DNA at the moment. And so there's a sort of what a party harnessing that kind of base could look like, you know, how Labour can kind of interact with social movements in the way Corbyn talked about before he was elected.
Good. Well, let's go along and see what people's responses to all of that is. And let's try and be positive. I mean, we know what the problems are. Let's try and think, are there any answers, any action things that we can come up with? Emma, do you want to start?
Yeah, thanks very much. I think that, first of all, on the right, I wanted to say also that I think, Sarah, your point about the family is really important, because I think there's one thing that differentiates a politics of the left. It would be to deprivatize precisely what happens in the home, and to think about different kinds of social structures. So that, to my mind, I think syncs very well with what Nick was just saying about how Corbyn, and I think also that what is happening at that level of parliamentary process provides us with the space. And if we don't organize, and if we don't actually think about what is happening in workplaces, in our communities, in neighborhoods, etc., then we are missing a trick, and we're losing an opportunity. And I guess I don't get up at 5 o'clock in the morning and stand outside the factory gates, not least I think over 90% of jobs in London are in the service industry, but I work in a university, and I think it's really important what I do in that space, also in terms of how I'm trying to organize with other people, also through my union. And so I think it is also particularly important for activists to remember that we live in particular places, and we work in particular places, and we have to organize where we are, and think also about the connections across where we live and where we work, how we live, how we work. I think it's those sorts of questions that are going to take us forward, rather than thinking about what the key is going to be, that one demand. And if we only structure that demand properly and in the right way, that's going to open up the gates for change. So I think really the emphasis on organizing.
Yeah, on the citizens' income, minimum income, absolutely, we have this problem with it's one of those things actually the right and left can often agree on in terms of a policy, but then they come at it very different ways. And I think if we can start talking about it within the language, I heard someone the other day speaking about the way that they sold kind of the welfare system in the first place around insurance and security and some of that language, and bring it into a very left way of doing it, then I think there's some way. I mean, the problem is, as soon as you get into any one of these policy ideas, so from jobs to pensions, it very quickly comes back to kind of the financial system and our whole economic system. This is real radical stuff, which a lot of people are quite scared of. So I agree that there needs to be some kind of path towards that, which is about, one, sorting out housing, two, sorting out childcare, because that is an issue that people can relate to and they do feel that it's very unfair. And then how we get onto these bigger things. For instance, if we start doing something about the financial sector, what does that mean for our pensions? Actually, our pensions are very much tied into the way that the finance sector works right now. So if we try and undermine that, what are we doing for our future security? And once people get wind of that, a lot of older people won't want that kind of change to happen. So we have to be very careful in the way that we stage this and think about what that route is. In terms of mobilizing, and a young person in an audience asked me the other day what it is that she could do or what they could do immediately. And I said that everyone can find in their place, if there isn't a way of organizing, if that place isn't part of a union, there's something they can do. Having those conversations with family. I'm from the Muslim community. I have some really awkward conversations with my family, and about both religion and politics. I never take it off the table, and it can be quite painful. And I think they still love me. But I think we have to, each of us, I think you're right, we have to take on our own responsibility as people of the left to make sure that we are reaching the people that we can, and organizing and reflecting the kind of politics we want to see.
Yeah. In regard to what Nick said around frame, I mean, you could call it frames. I mean, I'd probably call it a demand. Any movement historically has to have demands at its centre. Why? Because this is what brings together heterogeneous groups who would seem to be distinct from one another. So that could be around, you know, the Chartists, for instance. And how those percolate down to the grassroots don't even need to make sense. They can even be framed at the level of the individual. So, for instance, the Chartists had the People's Charter, but then there's a great quote, it was Christopher Hill or somebody, I don't know, some 19th century historian. And there was a Chartist working class man, and he said Chartism is a lamb supper, a few pints, and a six-hour day. And I think that demands are important. They need to be personalizable, and they need to be shareable. And I don't mean that in a sort of digital media context. I mean, that's always been the case. And that's what brings disparate groups together. That's what brings together the war veteran, the single mum, the disabled person. That's not everything. It's not like some alchemy. If we just get that demand right, then we'll be there. But it is significant. It's important. And then to feed back to what Emma said around local activism, I mean, it's a fantastic idea. But I think I moved to London 11 years ago, and I've lived in 20 places. You know, I've lived everywhere. Putney, Hackney, the whole, everywhere, every borough, you know? So it's a nice idea. I mean, how practical is it, especially in the big metropoli, London, New York, Paris? And then finally, what I would say is that the digital environment brings about something called organizational fecundity, which means that the range of organizational possibilities is wider than ever before. And that the idea that there is one kind of organization which will sort everything out, historically, that's been the party form, is very limited. And actually, whatever you want to achieve, whatever you want to do, there's an appropriate organizational form, and the range of possibilities is wider than ever. So we shouldn't be thinking, oh, this new organizational kind archetype replaces a previous one. It's very different to that, actually. It's much more interesting.
Well, so the question of localness is sort of interesting, and I would disagree a little bit. One of the most interesting sites of organizing in the States right now is Chicago. And the reason it's so interesting is you have a coalition of different groups doing different types of political work that has all sort of gelled at this point, and it took years. So the Chicago Teachers Union is one of the most radical in the country. And this is a union, primarily black women, who have lived in the community for years, had union jobs, had a relatively stable set up, although not always great. And when Rahm Emanuel attacked the public schools and he shut down 50 schools, I mean, this is extremely dramatic. And we're in the US seeing the privatization of public education and all of these things. These teachers had been not only organizing in a traditional way in their union, but practicing social justice unionism, which involved going out into the community, talking with the parents at the schools they were at, talking with the other people in the community who had anything to do with the schools, and also had reading groups. They were all reading Naomi Klein. And so this became a fairly radical and deeply rooted union. And at the same time, we've seen BYP 100, the Black Youth Project, growing ever since the killing of Trayvon Martin. They were a group that got started sort of around that moment and then were sort of reactivated around Ferguson. And so they've been doing a lot of organizing and a lot of working out the ideas that have become central to Black Lives Matter as a broad movement encompassing many groups. They recently put out a report that was an economic program for racial justice in America. And so all of these groups have sort of started working towards similar goals. And most recently, you saw the prosecutor who's responsible for Chicago. And she is a true abomination, as most American prosecutors tend to be. And was responsible for many long jail sentences and young people being prosecuted in horrible ways. And it's really monstrous. And all of these groups that had been active in the community worked together and they got her out in the next election. And that is not normally what happened. She had the backing of City Hall. She had the backing of Rahm Emanuel specifically. All of those people began to fall away a little as they realized that she was being targeted. But that was a real outcome. And there are going to probably be lighter jail sentences in that community. And it was also an expression of power, which hopefully will translate into something else. Hopefully, you know, something to do with schools, maybe. So that is a type of organizing that I think is setting a model in the States for how labor and racial justice can work together. And so when people ask what they should do after the Sanders campaign is over, I don't have a bunch of clear-cut answers, but it does seem that what needs to be done is the coalition building work. So if you are a white person, you should be very clear that you're supporting racial justice struggles and see like what the work is you can be doing that's helpful to that struggle. How are you in solidarity with that work? And if you're a man or a brocialist or, you know, the man guard or whatever, perhaps if you have been tangling a lot with liberal women on Twitter, you might consider like spending some time on gender. And are you on the left making sure that women's demands in particular, like how much do you know about abortion on demand? Do you know that you support it? Because you should. And are you acting in solidarity with a sort of gender struggle? Now, all of that makes it sound a little too simple. There's like no one gender struggle, one race struggle. That would be ridiculous. But within your community, are you working on the bridges? And I think if we're talking about building the sort of left coalition that we've all referred to, that is the post-campaign work.
I mean, one thing I'd add, as you mentioned Tony Negri and his factory work, which is a great story. I mean, I've done that as a Trotskyist in the 1980s, sold papers outside factories. We eventually came to the conclusion that if we actually wrote each person a letter who actually bought one, it would be cheaper than printing the paper. But now we don't need to because we have got networks and they're much better. But I suppose Maurice Glassman, who invented the term blue labor, calls me black labor because of Negri. I think that's not a bad thing, that describing what we need. We need something that's allied to, you know, the party is a tool for getting government and creating space. And then movements are movements. They exist whether or not the party gives them permission or not. Mm. But what you find often, and I think you find a lot of people with kind of high personal bandwidth. So basically, people like me or anybody on this platform, we're going to be listened to. Some of you in this audience, you'll be listened to. You're experts in your own field. And we'll all go to conferences about, well, what's the policy going to be? There's one this Saturday, you know, McDonald's, me and you are both going. Okay, but what you don't find, nobody tells us, right, your bit of it is you do New Jersey, or you know, you do Thanet, you adopt Thanet, and you go to Thanet every week or month, and you do work there. Because the party, the Labour Party, doesn't have that mentality. The people who have it are the community organising groups. You know, if you look at the way London Citizens has actually gone to the East End, they've got people, you know, from all university graduates, not necessarily from the same ethnic background as the place they send them to, and they go, that's your bit, get on with it. That's the Saul Alinsky method, the Alinskyite sort of American roots activism. That I, in answer to your question, I think that is what we have to start organising ourselves around, not waiting for somebody to tell us to do it.
Don't you feel there's a bit? I mean, I often find myself to be the only person from a kind of working class background of colour in many situations. In that, and so within the left and discussions, it's quite an awkward thing to say. But I guess, I mean, when we're saying you go out and do this and this is your bit, and people don't always feel that comfortable about going. I mean, I wouldn't feel that. I mean, I'm such a Londoner. I mean, I wouldn't feel comfortable about going to certain places as well. But we don't have enough diversity within the left. Sometimes I feel that the people that are listened to, and I think this is a very different type of panel. But unfortunately, what can we do to make sure that the people that are listened to, that are a bit more diverse, at least in terms of kind of the private state school split?
Can I just say something on that? Because I think it's really important that we remember that people do organize and people are thinking about stuff, and it's not for us as individuals or people who are listened to come up with what the demands should be. And I think that that is something that we always have to keep in mind. And of course, what Negri and others were doing in the factories was also, they did something that they called militant inquiries, and they were researching how work was organized. There were feminists who were thinking about what was happening in the home, and starting from problems and starting from questions, and through that process coming up with whether it's demands or also different ways of doing things. So I think that process of organizing is not coming up with the solutions, but actually starting from the problems.
Let's have three more questions. Put your hand up, please. Woman here. And then after that, where? Yeah, woman here, yeah, right at the front. And then we'll have you, sir, with your hand up there. So you first.
Hi, I'm Rosie. This is a bit of a less of an upbeat question, I guess. So, you know, I think it's understandable that, you know, given the kind of surprise of Corbyn, and none of us were expecting him to suddenly be the leader of the Labour Party, and suddenly one of our own is, you know, within the grasp of some kind of power. And so I think it's understandable that we're all, you know, trying to come up with programmatic demands and, you know, dreaming of what the future could and should be, and universal basic income and taking control of automation and childcare and all of these things. But one of the things that's preying on my mind a lot is that we're living in a country where union density is at the lowest that it's been in history, and organizing is not in the fabric of people's lives as it once was, and there is no mass social movement, although there are obviously pockets of organizing and some really good work being done. And then you look to Greece, where there were all of those things. There was union density, there were general strikes, there was a mass movement and a left government, and it was so easily crushed. What lessons do we learn from that? If Corbyn is successful, if we manage to put all these programs on the table, if the best possible situation happens, how do we not get crushed by the IMF?
You, sir, there with the mic.
Hi, I'm Joe with the Next System Project in Washington, D.C. This has been great. I wanted to ask the panel about new economic models and institutions as prefigurative of the future that we want. I wonder whether the panel has been a bit unfair to those missing generations. I'm looking at my fourth decade now, and one thing that we did was go off and create co-ops and land trusts. And if you look at the United States now, there's 130 million Americans in co-ops of one form or another, or there are more people engaged in worker ownership now than in unions in the private sector. And I wonder, it's in some ways it's surprising that this electoral turn has taken place. And is there a risk of moving into a sort of warmed over social democracy and a set of policy demands, rather than thinking about how maybe we scale all that work that's been done in these sort of intervening decades of neoliberalism, sort of below the surface of media attention?
One more question. Stick your hand up. You, sir, at the back there, with your hand up.
Hello, hi, I'm Kennedy. It's been really interesting and stuff. But I was just wondering, like, you've spoken a lot about like engaging people in politics that wouldn't usually be engaged and stuff like that. And I think there's one thing about talking to people and getting them to talk about politics and be ready to engage in politics, but there's another thing about making them trust politics enough to actually want to engage with it. So I speak to a lot of people, and whenever I talk about politics, I say they're not gonna vote. So it's one thing to say, like to let them know about the politics and getting the message out and having them hear the message and being like, I resonate with that. But then there's another thing about getting them to trust the establishment to engage with it in the first place. So it's kind of just going off the back of what the person said at the front, basically. And how can we not only get people to engage in politics, but like get them to trust it enough to then want to. And it kind of probably builds on what Emma was saying about getting them to talk about their own issues and stuff. But I just wanted to hear what the panel thought. Thanks.
Thank you for that, Sarah.
Okay. So to Rosie's question, I think that's a very good question. And the fact is, in the end, we may all be crushed. If
we've got 10 minutes, we've got to end on a high.
Well, I'm starting with that one. But it's true. We might be screwed. And I don't... I don't actually mean that in a flippant way. Like, I think that's true. Like, the idea that us together, we will be as strong or stronger than neoliberalism seems totally ridiculous. It's really hard to imagine. I don't claim I can even exactly imagine it. And watching Greece was absolutely heartrending and continues to be. I mean, it's been horrible. And so I guess when I think about this stuff, so the book itself is sort of quasi-programmatic. And the real reason we structured it the way we did as sort of solution-oriented was not because we thought we should deliver some solutions from mountaintop, which would be both stupid and ineffective. What we were trying to do was, you know, when we conceived of this, and again, this was before Bernie Sanders, so things were a little bit different. The American political imagination, I would say, had gotten very, very narrow. And it was super hard to think outside of the sort of options offered by the Democratic Party, which were very narrow, very weak, very neoliberal, especially for, you know, young people who were coming up at a time of 11% national union density and had no institutions to sort of structure their demands for the things that they wanted in a way that could be sort of marched toward. Large parts of the left were also exceptionally apologetic for anything that sounded like Marxism or socialism because that had been so demonized in the United States that nobody even wanted to say the words. And so the idea of conceiving of what we wanted is designed as sort of a mark of confidence. Like, we do want certain things. We'll happily call them socialist. We all want to move toward them together. And we think that they would work. So, in other words, the problem with something like universal childcare or solving the environment in a way that's redistributive instead of just tax credits or whatever, those things aren't impossible because we don't know how to do them, which is what the American narrative always is. Like, healthcare, how would it even work? Like, no one will markets. We need markets. And we actually totally know how to do these things, and we want to write that down. And so we really work through these problems from a socialist perspective because, especially on the environment, for example, there aren't always clear articulations out there of what that would look like. And we wanted them to be thought through and available to people. And if we're asking people to be socialists, which is way out of the American mainstream, we better be telling them what we mean by that. So that was sort of a gesture of confidence. Whether or not that will result in avoiding the neoliberal apocalypse, you know, I don't know. And I don't, you know, in many ways, I think maybe not. But what it does do is if we can collectively be somewhat confident and move towards something we actually want together, that creates the relationships that will be our last bastion of hope and that are in fact necessary in order to do anything. So that's sort of what we want. Like, can we develop a common sense of what a good world would be, move towards it together without apologizing for it?
Yeah, in regard to the international finance institutions, the IMF, the World Bank, all coming after us. I mean, we might not have to wait for Corbyn to win. It might happen, you know, the week ahead of the Brexit referendum. And actually, if you look at the left and Labour's position in relation to the EU referendum, I think that's really revealing. Because they say, well, look, let's wait till Corbyn gets into power and then we'll change the EU. And it's, no. If Corbyn was to become the British Prime Minister, highly unlikely, but if it transpired, the pound would be under attack, there'd be huge capital flight, every single European politician who mattered would be attacking him. So I think, you know, it'd be a bit more realistic, go for these things first, that's why I'm for Brexit. People say, well, that's kamikaze, that's stupid, fine. I think both arguments have their merits, actually. But there's a lack of realism in regards to the international finance institutions, which kind of irritates me. And also, I've said it a lot, but I really believe it, Britain is one of a select group of countries which could actually change these organisations. It won't do it by itself, but maybe with the states, it could happen. And this has to be a huge part of Corbyn's agenda, because what we're after is not changing British politics. We want a different kind of globalisation. And that's going to require different institutions. And only some countries can do this. You know, we want a different kind of UN. Security Council reform. Only some countries can do this, right? So when they say, oh, we're going to change the EU with these other 27 member states, three or four of them matter. Without being discourteous to anybody, right? That's the situation. What were the other questions? There were some great questions.
Well, there's a good prefigurative question, which, like, by the way, I did not mean to be unfair to your generation. I was merely following Paul.
I'll pick up on that.
Yeah, go.
Do you want to go?
I have a thought, but
yeah, after. Let's have your thought. Let's have your thought.
Okay. It was just that I don't want to discount those things, because one of the things you actually saw in Greece was that a strong infrastructure of cooperatives and so forth became a real source of political action and actually saved people's lives. I mean, there are medical clinics, and came to fill in for the state in a way that may not be desirable, but was very important. And I think that is going to be probably important at some point in the US. A lot of Black Lives Matter is interested in the Black Panther Breakfast Program, things like that. And that is one way of preserving community well-being, the ability to go forward within this system where the safety net is falling apart completely. And so there are a lot of radical African-American Southern cooperative projects that are especially interesting.
Can I just respond to that? Yeah. So in terms of, I think you call them Gen Xers, people like Tom Cruise's age, maybe you're the same age as Tom Cruise, sort of somewhere between the baby boomers and the millennials.
How old is Tom Cruise?
I don't know, right? You know, he kind of looks young, but he's not that young.
Just don't mention Scientology at all.
So, or Cocktail, my favorite film. So anyway, more of that later at the bar. In regards to where were these older people, when you look at the events and the movements of 2011, a lot of people said, oh, the reason why they're doing consensus, the reason why they've got working groups and affinity groups is it's an outgrowth of the technology. That wasn't true. The affinity groups element, perhaps, I think that was an expression of just technological affordances, mobile telephony, social media, the internet. But consensus, general assemblies, was an activist inheritance, which was actively pushed by sedimentary structures from particularly the climate justice movement. So these people were hugely important. And actually, again, both sides of the Atlantic, across Europe, there weren't that many of them. Real Democracia, yeah, which starts the 15M movement. This is a ginormous movement, Real Democracia, yeah, its core group's 25 people, you know, at the beginning. Very, very important. But then the kind of converse to that, and maybe this is overly critical, is I think David Graeber called it the new left, you know, the post-1989 left. I think we're at a historical moment now where we have to look at the left since 1989 and say, what has it done? What can be improved? You know, and what are the big mistakes that have been made? And, you know, it's time for honest assessment, I think. And
we probably haven't got much time to do that, though, now.
No. But I would say one thing is it's not a scalable politics. That's my criticism of it.
You mean the activism bit, the horizontalism is not scalable?
Right, the new social movement element.
Okay, Faiza.
Yeah, very quickly. I mean, just to agree, I was like a mole for about 18 months where I worked for an organization that meant that I could go into World Bank meetings and to the UN and see how it worked. And absolutely, if we can get the UK and the US to shift a bit on these things, then it will really affect the World Bank and the IMF. And it is the way in which, and this is why it's so important to have that UK-US link, because we are currently the leaders of that evil and we could turn that around. Yeah, so I absolutely agree on that. Let me just take up this issue of trust. And yeah, it's definitely something that comes up with me when I have these conversations. One is the issue of like, they're all the same, and also about trust. And actually that is where Corbyn is so helpful, and something that we're not making enough of, and the Labour Party isn't making enough of, which is this is the leader that, you know, did have low expenses, does come across like a person that cares, you know, isn't a typical politician. And certainly we need to be using him as a way to say that this is potentially is someone that you can believe in. And he is very different. You look at his voting record, you look at what he stood for in the past. But yeah, we have to be careful. I know that my husband talked his parents into voting for Nick Clegg when there was, do you remember that time when there was like a big thing about, oh, he's different and he's so, you know, and they were so upset. They were so upset with him. And after that, they've said, they basically said, we're not going to vote. So, you know, it is true. We have to really think about trust. And but Corbyn is potentially someone, you know, gives us something in that regard.
Are you saying that we're talking about abusive relationships here? Next time it will be different. I think that this question of the state is on the agenda, right? And I think that we can talk about it and we can think about whether it's the party form, our relationship to the state. We're not going to solve it today or tomorrow because it's a question that's ongoing. And somebody's calling on. It's a question that's ongoing. It's something that we're living Chomsky. Through and it's something that we have to... and it's something that we have to... We're going to have to resolve and solve through a political practice. It's not something that we just have the answer for now. And that's why I think books like the one that you have put together are really important, because they do give us an imagination, a possibility of thinking how things might be. And that, I think, relates to this issue of trust. Like, to my mind, it's not just trust about trust in political parties or trust in politicians, but it's also about trusting each other. And actually learning to trust each other again. And this has something to do with the individualization of society and the way that, you know, the me society that we live in now, and a profound distrust of one another, because we're all competing against each other all of the time, right? So how do we learn to trust one another, not just politicians and other people? And I wanted to say something about cooperatives as well, because I think, again, here it's really important not to sort of fetishize the form, because I think that what we're also seeing at the moment is a real interest on the side of capital in cooperatives and in this form of organization. And so I think there is a real fault line, also a fault line of struggle, of what does it mean to actually work and produce in cooperative form in a way that is different from how this is also being seen as a sort of new investment opportunity, a new business model that is lean, mean, and also ethical, and all the rest of it. So I think not sort of setting up a kind of opposition between the individual and the collective. Individual is horrible, collective good. Cooperative versus the sort of capitalist enterprise. But that we actually try and figure out these things as new fault lines of struggle as they present themselves to us.
Well, I'm going to wrap up there and try and just draw the strings of this discussion together, just with a personal kind of account. Being born in 1960, there's not many advantages to it. But one of them is to see capitalism, two models of capitalism, sort of hit their peak and then decline. So I've seen it with Keynesianism, seen it with neoliberalism, which I'm very convinced is broken and cannot survive in its present form. And then if you think about the left, I mean, a lot of the theme of questions like yours are things are so shit, how can we ever win? And I think it was important for you to say, you know, we can. Somebody said, you know, we can imagine that a non-neoliberal future, we can beat neoliberalism. The difference is, I think, you know, I came into the left, you know, in the late 70s, actually. And it was like Lord of the Rings. There'd already been this kind of great civilization. You had all these engineers saying, it's never going to come back, is it? The occupations, you know, the occupation of factories, upper-class shipbuilding. It's never going to happen again. And you saw this long tapering of people's perspective. Now, I think, however depressed you are about the present, what you'd have to bear in mind is that the people from my generation look at this generation and its achievements already in terms of what has been happening. We never got Tony Benn to anywhere near to the leadership, you know, really to the leadership of Labour. We never got HSBC and Starbucks so terrified of a mass movement, it's like paying tax involuntarily. And I think you have to then believe that your own generation has only just begun. Because the trajectory is, it's like a firework. It is upward. And so I just wanted to leave it on that note. I think, to somebody who's seen both sides of it, this is much better than what the 1980s felt like. So go on. Anyway, that's it. And buy the book.